Okay, can you see my screen? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we'll start with the today's session. That is related to the programming concepts. So I'll show you some questions that are based on the programming codes, and we have to solve it and find what will be the answer for that given code. That is what the today's session we have for the C programming and the data structure. Okay. So this is what the code. We have to find a factorial of a given number. And you have to tell what will be the output for this. Excuse me. You already done with the C programming, right? You have done C programming before. Yes. You are a BTech students, right? Hello. Yes, am I audible to you all? Can you hear my voice?
Ma'am, you're audible. I don't think the electrical students learned C programming.
You're BTech students, right?
So I'm a BTech, but there are various branches. Like we got CAC and electrical in the same batch. Okay. At least I'm electrical, and I don't think I learned C programming.
But in the first, I think first year you have the C programming, and for first year, all of you have the same syllabus, no? For all the branches, as per
NAPS. No, ma'am. From okay. What I remember, we learned Python, not C. So,
okay. So you are done with the Python, not C.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, that is strange because C is the, I think, foundation of all the programming languages. C. So you must learn the C first. If you learn C, then all the other programming language you will easily learn those programming language. So this is a given C program. In which I'll tell you what is given over here. Nobody knows the C programming. Yes. So branches are combined over here, right? Just now he said that all branches are there. So the students from computer and IT, I think they know about the C programming. And I think more than 50 participants will be there. Right now only 19 are attended. Why?
Ma'am, we have other class, ma'am.
But the schedule, the session is scheduled for you, no? At 5 to 9, from 5 to 9. Okay, if anybody doesn't know about this, this program will give you an error. So I will explain the, I will show you the question. If you know C programming, then it will be very easy for you to understand what is the output for this given program will be. Okay, so here what we have given is, they have given a long int data type. We know there are different data types in any languages. We have int, double, float, long int, short int. So here they have given the variable long of a data type long int. Fact is equal to 1, means fact is the variable which is initialized with the value 1. Then along with fact, there are two more variables, n and I taken. Okay. Then after that, the scanf statement is written. Scanf is used for taking the input from the end user or the user of your program. Here, the error will be given for this scanf statement. Why? Because %d is used for the integer data type. Instead of %d, it should have to give %ld, long int. No? So for that, it should give %ld. And this is what the error it will have. Even for the printf statement, the same error will be there. Okay, so this program will you give you an error that you have to give %ld instead of giving just a d. So that is the logical error you will have. See the answer just now. I'm showing the answer also. It will give you the logical error that you have declared your fact and n as a long int, but when you are accepting the or printing the data variable, you have given %d, which is a integer, which is used for an integer type. You have to give ld, that is for the long int. Okay, then we'll go for the next. Complete the given code. Okay. Complete the given code means what? We have to write the code over here inside this while loop. And what we are doing in this is to reverse the integer. Means what? The for example, if I will give number as a 2345, I have to reverse the order. Means this is 1000 place, this is 100 place, this is tens place, and this is your ones place. I have to reverse the order. Means 5432 should be the order of your integer number. This is what the code you have to write. So how you're going to write this code, I'll directly show you the answer and I'll explain this, because if you people know, don't know about the program C programming, then I have to help you in that way only. Okay, now we start with the main function from here. Okay, in the main, what we have taken, one variable n. One is for reversing the integer, which is initialized with the zero, and remainder is the another variable. Then what? Rev is the reverse integer, means whatever the input integer value we have taken, the output will going to be inside this rev, rev variable. So this print statement will ask you to enter the integer from your console. Then scanf will accept the number which you have taken. Now when you enter a number, that value will get stored in the variable n. Now while n is not equal to 0, okay, n is not equal to 0 means all the values in the n, that is not, means the value of n is not equal to 0 till that you are going to complete the code, means you are going to execute the code for reversing the integer. And the logic here, you can see that first you have to write that remainder. You are going to calculate the remainder of this. Why we have to do that? You can see that this is the ones place, tens place, 100 place, and 1000 place. When you divide, means when you do the modulus operation on the number, the last digit will get eliminated, right? So when you divide this, the modulus will be sorry, the last digit will get eliminated from this. So the remainder you will get 2345 mod 10. Will you give what it will give you as a remainder then? Yes, this also you can explain. This also you can tell what with the result of that. If you do mod 10.
The ones place digit.
Yes, that is will be the ones place digit, na? 5, right? And that we have to bring as a first in your reverse number. Am I right? This is what the logic of the program. That last digit, we have to bring it as the first digit in the reverse order number. So this has to be executed till the end of your all the digits that you have in your integer number. So this statement is used. So remainder will be the 5 for the first time. Okay, in the first execution of your loop, the remainder will give you 5. Then what we have to do is reverse is equal to reverse into 10 plus remainder. Meaning what? It will add the reverse. Why we have to do the multiplication over here? Because we have to make it in the 1000 place. So every time when the next number is going to add, it has to go to the next digit place. Means the second digit will get added. The 5 will go to the 50, means 10th place. Third digit will get added. 5 will go to the 100th place. That way we have to increase the number of digits in the rev. That means the reverse order number. And then the end is giving us n is equal to n divided by 10. Why we use this? So you will get the next number every time for a n. When you do this, this last digit will get every time removed. So this is how the logic is used for reversing the number. And when the last digit will finish, n is going to give you value 0. So you will come out of this loop. And then, because it will come out of the loop and it will print the reverse order number. So this is how the logic of this reversing an integer program can be executed. And this is how the code you have to write in the given question. Is it clear for you? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, it is clear now. Now, third question we have. Function or method number count. So here a function is given named as a number count. It accepts the 3 arguments. Okay, length, then integer representing the length of input list. Okay, so there will be a list of integer, means an array, and length is the size of that array. Then what? ARR, that is what? A list of integers, means an array with the some numbers and a value, okay, and integer value. And what it should return? It returns an integer representing the sum of all the elements of array that are equal to the given integer value. Okay, for example, they have given the length of an given length is given as a 9, so there will be 9 elements in your array. So 9 elements will be there over here, and the value which is given is the integer value, and it returns an integer value. So what we have to do in the function, it returns an integer representing sum of all elements, sum of all elements that are equal to the integer given in a value. Means this value 2 is present in this array, and we have to find how many times this value occurs. And every time when we got that value, we just going to add it into the sum. So you can see here 2 is here 1, 2, and 3 times 2 is there. So 2 plus 2 plus 2 we have to do, and it should give the result as a 6. This is what the program they have to do. What they have written here, function compiles successfully but fails to return the desired result. This means there is a logical error, not the syntax error. when you compile a program and it won't give the error, but it is not giving the correct output, the meaning of this is what? It is having a logical error. Okay. So what is our task is, your task is to correct the code so that it passes all the test cases. Okay, just go through the code. So what we have here is number count is the present is the given function. Okay, first problem we can see here only that we don't need to put a pointer variable for the length value or the length variable. So we have to eliminate this star. So it will be a simple integer length should be there because it is not an array. It is just a simple variable. Then what second we can see that I is less than zero. You can see this for loop also. Yes, it is also incomplete. Am I right? It is also incomplete. So what we have to do, we have to write it in a proper way. We are starting the see, 9 we have taken over here. Okay. And but here what we are doing is we are taking till the 8 values only in the for loop. If start with the 0, either you have to give the equal to sign for this I is less than condition, or you have to make it as a only length. So all the elements would get considered. And after that, there should be a I value increment condition also you have to put in the for loop. That is also one thing left with the for loop. And the remaining things are okay because count plus plus they are doing. And then return. See here, they have written as a sum, but sum is not used anywhere. We have to write here count because count is going to be incremented every time, right? So this should be sum is not written. So it will again give you the error that there is a no sum variable. You have to write count over here. So these are the errors we have, which we have to change. So the answer will be parameters are wrong. Correction to be done in the for loop and the return value. I think I have explained you all the things which you have to change in the code. Yes, everybody. Yes, please give me a reply so I can think that I am teaching you and you are listening. Otherwise, I will thinking that all of you, because we are not even one-to-one conversation is not there. You people are so many screens. I cannot see all the screens because I have to show you the presentation also. I want the interactive session with me. Otherwise, I won't able to know about what you are doing. Means, are you listening or not? Yes. So the next time I will give just show you the question and I'll ask the answer only. Should I do that or should I explain the things? Yes.
Explain, ma'am.
So I want the interactive session for that. Otherwise, I will also lose the interest of teaching. Okay, so this is the next one. Otherwise, I have to inform the the organizer about this, that students are not giving the showing the interest in the session. Should I do that then? Yes. Okay. The next question we have is the find the syntax error in the below code with modifying logic. Do you know what is enum is? Enum is nothing but the data type. It is a user defined data type used in a C programming. it assigns the name to the integral constant, means the integer value has been taken, integral constant has been taken instead of a string or the names. So here we have the enum data type, enumeration we can say this, and this starting from Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, all have been there, which are the names. Okay, so when we are going to access this, this Monday is nothing but the zero. Integral constants are start with the 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. So what is the error in the given program logic? Yes. Who is going to tell me?
Ma'am, I don't understand enum.
Enum, that is what I've told you, just like a structure or the union in the user in the C programming. Enum is the user defined data type. Okay, see here the syntax of writing an enum is enumeration data type. You have to write enum, then you have to give the name for the variable, that is the variable name. So week is the variable name of type enum. Okay, and these are the names that going to be assigned to the integral constant. Okay, means like your normal integer array, you have the values, right? And using the index, you're going to use the array, right? Here, names are assigned to the integral constant. Means 0 is accessed as in Monday, 2 is accessed as in, sorry, 1 is accessed on Tuesday, then Wednesday will be 2. This way, the name is assigned for the values here. Understood? So day is the variable of type week. This is the user defined data type. So day will be the object. Now when you're going to access a day, see what they have written here. Day is equal to WED. Hence Wednesday they are saying. Okay. Now when this is used, error over here is this X. Instead of X, you have to put day inside this. This is the one error you have. Okay. And day, in day, instead of giving in the quotes, you have to give like as it is WED. Means the quote should not be there when you are going to assign the values to the enum of variable object. Okay. So that is what the error here. Yes, that is the error. The day variable must be declared as follows, means day is equal to WED. Okay, on which the value of day, it would be 2. Yes, I told you now the value will be integral constant value will be 2 then. So it will go for the case 2 Wednesday is chosen. Okay, understood?
Yes, ma'am.
So in switch statement, enum works. Means switch statements can be work on the enum data types also. Okay. Syntax error is there because when assigning any values from the enum data type, there is no need to put the quotes. You directly you can assign it because it is accessed with the integral constant. Okay. Now the next question we have is fix the error. This is kind of a tricky question you have. Very simple code they have given. Okay. Fix the error. Recompile and match against the output provided. What they have given over here is print. We assure 100% placement and return 0. Okay. So what we want is we have to print the statement that we assure 100% placement in the as a output of this program. Yes, anybody knows what is the error in this? Yes. Nobody knows what is going to be the error in this.
Main function parameters.
Main function?
Parameters are given. Avoid.
No, it won't be the error for this. We can put void in the main function also. It is not the error. Yes, anybody else? We have a 4 hours, so you can think and you can tell.
I think it should be backslash before the percent since.
There should be a
backslash before the percent.
No.
So it's not seen as a special character within the string.
No. Yes, you're right. The partially you're right that there is a problem with the percent. The percent symbol we are using in the printf statement. So how you're going to eliminate means how you're going to remove this error?
Add one more percentage sign.
Yes, that is correct. You have to add the one more percent sign in this. Why? This is a syntax error. It must be except. But if you have to use it, then you have to add one more percent sign. Okay? In the C, because 2 time percentage if you give, then it will print the percent. Percent sign in your printf statement. Okay, now we have the next question. What changes must be made to the program such that the compilation succeeds and 1 space 4 is printed in the output? Okay, they have given the comments also where you have to do the changes. See. What they have given, a is equal to 24 or I minus equal to 1. I minus equal to 1 means I is equal to I minus 1. Yes, nobody knows. So what they have given, you need a L value at the left operand of the assignment. We are doing the logical OR operation is there, right? So you need the L value of the left operand of the assignment. Means what? I minus equal to I, it should not be there. Instead of this, you have to use the I minus minus. If you do this change, then it will work. The code will work. Okay. Now this one is the another one. What we have to do is we have to print the desired output. when you start to learn C programming, such kind of programs you have to do as an assignment. I think I have done such kind of assignment during my C programming classes. Yes. Do you know what is the ASCII value of six? This A, capital A. Yes. What is the ASCII value of a capital A?
65.
Yes, 65. So you have to remember that how you're going to print this desired output. How you are going to modify this program to get the desired output. There is a only single modification you have to do. Can you see that where A they have given, and every time percent C where plus J means ASCII value they are using over here every time for printing the character, right? Am I right or wrong? They're using the ASCII values, right? Now you see value of A is 65, okay? Value of B is 66. Value of A is then 69, right? J, for a J, what is the value of J then? 74. Right, 74 is the value of J, right? And for Q? With a pen and paper, you can do this calculation and you can find what the changes you have to do in this.
I'm 81.
Yes, Q is a 81. So see the difference in these. There will be difference as 1. Here 3 will be there, right? Here 4 will be there. No, 5 will be there, no? And 8 will be there here. Okay. So how you're going to change this? So you will get this kind of a desired result. These nested for loops are simple to understand. Means what we are doing starting from the 5 means 5 times I will going to be executed, but this is going to executed for 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. Because condition we have given here, right? J is less than equal to 5, right? Here, the change you are going to do is J is equal, not J just, you have to make J into J. Okay, so 65 will be there constant. And every time when you go for the iteration, the J value has to be changed, right? So do the calculation for every loop iteration. You will find that it will print this, this desired output format. So first time when it will execute, J is 0. Right? So it will print A only. Next time J is going to be 1. So J into J will be 1. So 65 plus 1, it is going to print B. Then J is equal to 2. So 65 plus 4 is going to happen, means it is going to be 69, right? Then it will be 3. So 9 is going to be there. So 65 plus 9, it is going to give you 74. Then what we have? 65, 4, 3, 4. 16 will be there. So it will give you 81. So this way it will print the A, B, E, J, and Q for the first time of jth loop. Then again, it will go for the next I, right? So this way, all these desired output characters will get printed in your example. Okay. So what the answer they have given, is there is an error. The first two lines are Y in C++. Okay, so you have to remove the error also, no? So these two are for a C++. Instead of this, you have to use hash include stdio.h. Okay, and what also the printf must be modified. That is what the modification you have to do. That instead of writing just single J, you have to write J into J. Okay, understood the concept and understood the logic for this, everybody?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then we have the next problem. Find the logical error in the below code. Yes, who will tell me what is the logical error in the given below code?
Man, the first for loop should be I++ instead of I plus equals 0.
Yes. No. And another one. See, the if you are giving a semicolon at the end, immediate after the for loop, it will won't execute the for loop. This will be not going to execute it, the semicolon. Okay. So we use a semicolon in C statement to tell the compiler where's the end of our statement. Okay. Second, for the loop executes one time. Also, the I isn't incremented properly. See here, I is not incremented properly. This is one error. The semicolon will terminate this loop here only. Okay, so you should not give this semicolon after this. Okay, and what they have given, J is equal to I. J is less than N, J plus plus. This is okay with that. This two, these are the two. Sorry. These are the two problems or the errors that we have to remove. We have to remove the semicolon, otherwise it won't execute all both the for loop, because this for loop is the nested one. Means inside this for loop, the second for loop is written. That's why you have to remove this semicolon. And second thing is what? I plus equal to zero is done. That is the correct one. You have identified that it should be I++. Then we have the next one. Okay. Correct the following piece of code. Also, name this algorithm. Just go through the algorithm. From the looks only, I can say that this is a kind of a sorting array algorithm. Okay. I'll give you the hint that this is a kind of a sorting technique. Now think in that way and tell me which sort is done in this.
Selection sort.
Yes, correct. It is a selection sort. And what corrections you have to make over here? Is there any correction required over here? See, I start with the zeroth element to n minus 1. Yes, J will start with the first element. Minimum index we have to take, that will be start with the first location, that is ith. Then what we have to check with the ith location, we have to check which is the next minimum number starting from I to N, correct? So whichever the number we find, we are going to swap it with what? The I and the minimum index, correct? So there will be no other correction. I think there is a no correction in the program. And this sorting technique is the selection sort. Correct. Okay, now we have the next question. Okay, what is the question is saying that complete the below code by reusing the existing function. Find the index of equilibrium element in the given array. Okay, in an array, equilibrium element is 1 where the sum of all the elements to the left side is equal to the sum of all the elements in the right side. Okay, so understood the problem. What is the equilibrium elements is and what is the meaning of equilibrium? And return value minus 1 if there is a no equilibrium, and it will return the element with the least index value if there is a equilibrium. So what we have here, see in the test case, they have given the array 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, 3. And the index they have given is the 4. 4 is the element of equilibrium. So the left side sum is 1 plus 2 plus 3. And the right side sum is 3 plus 3. So there is an equilibrium for this particular test case, right? So what we have to do is complete the below code by reusing the existing function. Okay, the code has been given next to this slide. Okay, just go through this side, through the code, and tell me what changes you have to do in this code. Okay, what they have given is we have to do the updation in the code, means you have to type the code over here. That is what the thing they have given for solving the question. I think it is easy because they have, as the problem told, says that you can use the previously written functions also, right? So what we have here is we have the left side sum function is there, right side sum function is there. So it is easy for you what you have to write in this find equilibrium index function. Yes, anybody wants to try what we have to write over here? We'll get sum here and here also from the left side sum and right side sum. Okay. So what we have to check in the find equilibrium index is both sums should be equal. Then it will return the minimum index, right? Otherwise it will return the minus one. Okay, Nobody knows what kind of a logic or the code we have to write here. Should I tell then? See, we have to find the equilibrium index for the given array. This is the array and this is the size that we have given. Okay. For each and every index, we are going to find whether this is the index where we find the equilibrium. Fine. So that index we have to find. So we can add a for loop in this. Like this for loop you're going to add. Okay. From start to the end of array. Means from 0 to the value n. And inside that we can write the if condition for checking the sum which we get from the left side sum and right side sum. Here the passing value of index for the function is going to be I, which is we are going to write inside the for loop. Okay, so that will be the thing we are going to add in this function, and we'll check the condition. If it the condition is true, means there is a equilibrium, then we return that index I value as a minimum index where you find the equilibrium. Otherwise it will return the minus one. So that part only you have to add. You have to add a for loop that will start from I equal to 0 till n. Then you are going to add if condition in which you are going to write that if left side sum, inside the left side sum function you are going to pass the array a n, and index is nothing but the I, means I value that is inside your for loop is equal to right side sum function's return value, that is same values you are going to pass, that is a n and I. Okay, so this will give you the sum at that particular index position. Am I right? And then you will find that whether there is a equilibrium or not for the given index. So you will get the index also from the adding these two functions in a for loop. So that is what the solution for this. Okay, now we have the next function. Ishwar is a 6 years old boy who loves to play the numeric Lego. One day Ishwar's mom created a number using those Lego and asked him to tell the number of elements available between two specific numbers, alpha 1 and alpha 2. After 15 years, when he started learning C, he now wants to write a C code to find the number of elements lies between the ranges, alpha 1 and alpha 2. Okay, so there will be two numbers, alpha 1 and alpha 2, and they have to find out the number that ranges between these two numbers. Find the numbers of elements lies in the range. Okay. So input will be 3 space separated integer. Okay, first is the length of array. Okay, then second is the starting point as alpha 1 and third is the end point as alpha 2. Okay, so 9 will be the size of array. 2 is the starting index and last is the third is the end index of your array. Okay, so 2 is going to be in the example as 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, they have given. So 2 will be this number and 6 is going to be this number. So output is going to be, okay, what is the second is the starting point of alpha 1. So this is going to be the starting point of alpha 1 and output is going to be like 1, 2, 3, 4. You have to find the error in the given code. Just go through the code and you will find the error in this. What this first for loop is doing, this is just for accepting the values in array. Okay. Then what we are doing is we have to print the indexes, right? We have to print the indexes. That's why the printing output is 1, 2, 3, 4. We have to print the index over here. See. But the condition is that index should be the less than or equal to starting point, and the last index is j index is going to be the, and so the j index should not be exceeded the ending point. So what is the error in this code, they're asking. Yes, anybody knows?
Java.
See, one error I'll tell you that, see here they have written less than equal to sign. Okay, and your array start with the zeroth index. Am I right? Length you're taking initially from the user. Okay. So this is a one logical error you have. You are going to take the input if length you have given as a 5. Okay. Then you are taking the elements. How many elements you are taking over here is the 6 in an array. So this is one logical error you have that you have to remove. See, error found in the two if statements. Okay. And the include hash include directive isn't proper. Okay. That is also not written in a proper way. And in the if statement also, what they have given is arr of j. The space should not be there when you are writing this kind of a condition. So that is what the error, and this is the logical error that you have to remove. That also it should mention in the answer. Okay, this is what the error in the given problem. Next problem we have is, what modification must be made so that the program prints 30? Yes, do you know what it is? This statement. It is a ternary operator. Okay, ternary operator have the 3 conditions in it. That's why it is called as a ternary operator, because it is having 3 different expressions. First expression is known as a conditional expression. There will be a condition which is given before this question mark. Okay. And then the 2 other conditions have been given. Fine. Second expression and third expression. And what we have to do is, we have to first evaluate the condition expression. Based on the result of condition expression, we have to choose which condition expression we are going to use for as a result. So if there is one expression E1 is given, and then the question mark will be there, and they have given E2 colon E3. Okay. This will be get evaluated. If it is giving a value true, means this will, after evaluation of first expression, if it is giving the value true, then you have to evaluate the expression 2. Okay. But if it is false, then you have to evaluate the expression 3. So this is how the ternary operator works. Now here you can see that we have given first condition expression here is 5 is less than 8. Okay. And what the program is saying, that what modification you must be made so that the program print 30. So what they want to execute, they want to assign value of x as a 30. So how this expression is going to be execute? Yes, anybody knows, can tell what will be the changes we have to do here? See, what we have is 5 is greater than 8. So it will give you the value 0 because this is false. Okay. After this, we have the question mark over here. And then what they have given is 10 colon, the another expression they have given, right? And for this, what they have given, 1 is not equal to 2 is less than 5. So this is going to be 1 because 2 is less than 5 is in the precedence. You have to first solve this expression. According to the operator precedence, you have to solve this expression. So first, this less greater than operator will come. So you have to solve this expression first. Okay. Then you have to solve this one, the less than 1. So this will give you the answer correct 1. 1 is not equal to 1. So hold this part, it will give you answer as a 0. Because 1 is equal to 1, right? So 0, 0 we are getting. So which value this is going to be take? Sorry, 1 is not equal to not equal to 1 they are going to take. So it will give you the value as 0. Yes, I am right. So it will take the value 30 over here. So what changes we have to make in this is, yes, anybody knows? Or you don't know how to use the ternary operator? See what changes they have said, that you have to make 5 less than 8. Sorry, 5 is greater than 8 must be 5 less than 8. Okay, so you will get the answer as a program. It will print the answer 30 over here. Okay, then we have a program that is for a MCR, NPR means permutation and combination formulas that we use in the maths. So what we have over here is complete the program such that MCR and NPR printed. You can add more functions to make the code coincide. So what we have to do here is we have to add the code in this problem to write the function for NCR and NPR. If you remember the formula for finding the values of NCR and NPR, the permutation and combination formulas, we just have to add those formula in terms of program in this particular code. That is what the simple thing. Yes, anybody knows? Can you tell what is the formula for NCR? So see, these are the formulas that we have for a NCR and NPR. So which function we are going to use for this exclamatory mark? Yes, at least that much you tell. Which function we have to use for this?
Factorial.
Yes, factorial you have to use. So just what we have to do, we have to use the factorial function and we have to use the same formula inside this function. So you will get the function for a NCR and MCR. So this is all how you're going to write the code for it. The same code is there. I've just added that. See, for a NCR function, result is equal to N. For a NCR, it is N divided by R into N minus R factorial, right? All are factorial, N factorial divided by R into N minus R factorial. And for NPR, N factorial divided by N minus R factorial. And here R into N minus R factorial will be there. So these are the two formulas, which are, these are the mathematical one. And in the program, you're going to write like this. And the factorial function, the recursive function we use. Do you know what is recursive function is? Yes. What recursive function does?
A function calls itself.
Yeah, so the factorial is the recursive function. Every time it will call itself. Here it is not recursive one. It has just taken the number and they have computed the result like this only. Okay, this is not a recursive function taken. Simple for loop is used for finding the factorial. Fine. So you will get the result from the formulas, and this is the what the code you have to add in the program that they have given over here. Okay. Now we have another program. The function P triangle prints Pascal triangle that you might have studied while studying binomial theorem in mathematics. A user will enter how many number of rows to print. Okay, so user is going to enter the how many numbers you have to print in the that triangle, Pascal triangle. The first four row of the triangles are. So what they have given, see, they have given the code. We'll go through this. But before that, through the input and output, I just want to show how the output has to be. Input they have given as a 4, means number of rows they want for the Pascal triangle are 4. And the output means the Pascal triangle is should be like this in terms of a number. So again, it is using the computation formula only. Combination formula it is using for NCR. That NCR formula is used for the Pascal theorem. Okay, binomial theorem for drawing the Pascal triangle. So you can see this. They have written this printf statement how you are going to print the numbers. Okay, initially what we have to take input we have to take. So here also you can see that N they have taken as an input. Then we have to put the spaces also, because this one is going to be not in the middle of this, all the printing statements. So before starting with the first number, you have to put spaces. How many spaces you are going to print? That is based on the condition this N minus I minus 2. N is nothing but the number of rows that you have to print. I is the counter inside your for loop. And minus 2, why? The two jumping of two spaces you have to do every time. So I minus 5 is given over there. Okay, so this will print the spaces that you need in between the numbers. Then what? This is just for printing the entire triangle. Okay, the space and the numbers we are going to print in this. So what changes you need for this? See, this is how the formula, actually I have taken the formula also, how the formula will get evaluated for writing the, for printing the triangle. So you can see the exponent value, which we are going to relate with the for loop values. Okay, when you have a 4, 3, 2, 1, the exponent, how your triangle is going to be developed. Okay, for 4 rows, you need 3. Exponent will be 3. Okay. And this is what the this is what the program that you have to write for this Pascal triangle. number you're going to add, then the space, the same same problem program is I have written over here. Okay, just for printing, you have to remember how, the format of printing, how you're going to print it. So this kind, this for loops, you have to remember how you are going to write. Then what we have next is a for the generation of energy of energy at the atomic center, the energy is used to start the plant is in the negative sign. Okay, the energy generated after the plant started is represented with the positive sign. Our task is to calculate the total number of energy that is generated throughout the day. Below is the codes in a C programming, but it is not working well. Okay, find the errors in the code. So you have given the code over here and you have to find what is the problem with the code. Just check out with the code and tell me what kind of errors it will have. Yes, nobody knows. Have you understood the problem actually? What we have to do is we have to take one array in which the total reading we have to take. Means for the entire day, the number of readings are going to be taken for the energy that we have to take as an input. Okay, two inputs we have to take. One is the number, the time of energy was recorded as a total reading. And the second is the reading of energy used to produce the array. Okay, so array will be there that will have the number of readings, and one number is taken, which is the number of total reading, that is nothing but the size of your array. Okay, and what we have to compute is we have to compute the sum of total energy produced. Means what? We have to take one input which is known as a total reading, which is nothing but the size of the array. Okay, the second thing we have to take is the number of readings of the energies, means the numbers in your array of a size total reading. Understood? And what we have to give as an output is sum of the total energy, means we have to do the addition of all the numbers that we have in the array. So this is what the simple program we have to do. They have given in terms of some word problem. Okay, so you understood what we have to do. We have to do the sum of all the elements that are present in the integer array. So what they have given is the total reading I, that is the index we are using, right, and the array. Then scanf, we are doing it, that is correct. The third sentence, you can see again we have the problem with this. They have given less than and equal to. It should be only less than because we are starting with the zero. Okay, so this is one error. Then again, okay, this is also correct. Here also you can see percent C they have given for a sum, but it is of a integer type. So these are the two things, means the two errors we have in the program. Okay, incorrect loop termination in the first loop, that is one, and one is this. Int C they have given, but we need int D because integer variable is there. Yes, next is you are required You are required to write a program for a circular queue. You need not write the entire program. Complete only the below mentioned function. Okay. What functions they have given? Given is int item size, front and rear are minus minus. Do you know what is mean by a queue or a circular queue? Yes, anybody? What is mean by circular queue? Yes, nobody knows what is circular queue. Circular queue, basically, it is the type of a data structure. It is called as a linear data structure in which the items are, elements are going to be added from one end, which is called rear, and the items or the elements will get deleted from the data, from the queue. That end is called as a front. Okay, that's why they have given here, see, front and rear. So rear is the part, part of a queue from where the elements are going to be added, and front is the part from where they are going to be deleted. Okay, so which functions we have to write is NQ function. NQ function is nothing but the function through which we are going to insert the element in the queue. DQ is the function that will delete the element from your queue. And display is the function that is used for displaying the elements that are present in the queue. Okay. Circular queue means what? When you have a normal queue, front and rear are not going to match. Okay. Linear way. But in circular queue, when your queue is full, okay, when your queue is full, the next element you're going to add, sorry, when your queue is full and you have and one element you have deleted from it, your front is going to point to the next location, okay? And when it was full, the rear location is going to be the max one. So when you're going to add the new element, your rear is going to be point for the first location. Means circularly, they are going to do the addition in the queue. How that I will show you. Okay. Now you can see that the circular queue is kind of a circular way it is represented. Okay. So when you're going to do any NQ operation means adding the element in your queue. See, front and rear at the start, they are pointing to the same location. Okay. But when you add an element, your rear is going to be incremented, but your front is kept as it is. It won't change its location. See, when we are adding 14, your rear is going for the next location. When you add the next element, the 22, your rear is going to point for the next location. See, 13, again, it is going to point to the next location. So every time when you add the element in the queue, rear is going to be incremented. Okay. And when you are going to delete the element from your queue, your front is going to be incremented. You can see over here also, the front will going to be delete. After deleting the element, front is going to start moving. Means incrementing every time. Now you can see here, the elements we have deleted, only two elements are there. So rear is here, front is here. Now, again, when you're going to add the new elements, rear will start to moving. This way, the circularly they move, front and rear. Okay, this is what the concept of circular queue. Now what? We have seen this circular queue. Now we have to check the condition when we are going to insert any element in your queue and delete any event from your queue. Which conditions you are going to check? Okay. First thing is when you are going to insert, You have to check whether your queue is full already or not. How you are going to check that? You have, because we are using the circular queue, there are multiple options. There are more options to check how your queue is full. See, first thing that you are going to check is the rare index is equal to size minus 1. Okay, means what? Rare is incremented when you add element. Okay, so this rare comes to the maximum size if there are all elements. But along with that, we have to check the front is at the starting position only. So for that, we are using the ANDing operation for checking that front should be at the start only and rare is at the maximum index. It means that there is a full queue is full with the elements. Along with this, what we are doing is we have to check that rare is equal to front minus 1. The meaning is same that because we are using the circular queue, sometimes it won't be at the location of the start and the end. It might be somewhere else because we are doing sometimes we add, sometimes we delete. So rear and front are going to be kept moving circularly. So this is the next condition we have to check every time. If the indexes of front and rear are not at the starting and ending index. Okay. So this should be true, then your queue is full. If one of the statement is true, then your queue is full. This is one condition we are going to check when we are going to add the new element in your queue. Okay. Then next what? If it is full, then display queue is full. If queue is not full, then what we are going to check? Rare is equal to size minus 1. Means what? The end is there and front is not equal to 0. Means what? Your rare end has been reached, but your front is also moved, means the elements from the front location has been deleted. If it is true, then set rare to 0. Means what? Rare will start from the first index and insert the element. Because it is a circular queue, okay, when the front elements are going to be deleted, if for this example, suppose now here the front is deleted, so it will come to the 22. And here the 14 was there, which is removed. Now, if from here, rare, if I have added one element over here, suppose 10, okay. And now I have to add one more element in the queue, circular queue. Front is not at the zeroth position because we have removed the 14th element from this circular queue. Okay. Now, rare is here. And he has to add the new element. We have to add the new element. So it will check that it is at the max position, but front is not at the starting position because we have removed one element from here. So what we are going to do is we are going to change the rare location, which is at the max. It will go for the zeroth location. Okay. That is what the this if condition tells you. How you are going to do that? Set the rare location to 0 and insert the element in it. Okay, same way for a dequeue operation, means delete the element from queue operation. What we have to check is whether queue is empty or not, that you are going to check. How you will check that? You check that front is assigned to minus 1 or not. Means if the front is assigned to minus 1, means there is no element added in your queue. If it is empty, then display the queue is empty. Okay, if this condition satisfied, then you're going to display that your queue is empty. If queue is not empty, then what you're going to do, what checks you're going to make is if front is equal to rear. The meaning of this is when you have only single element, see, for this first element only, a condition is satisfying, right? Front and rear both are pointing to the same location. The same way, when you have only one element anywhere in your queue, circular queue, this condition is must be satisfied that front is equal to rear. So if it is true, then set front and rear equal to minus 1. Why? Because this condition tells you that there is only one element is left in your queue. Then what we have to do? We have to make the both front and rear to the minus 1. So it shows the empty queue condition. And then else what you're going to check is, else you have to check that front is equal to size minus 1, means if there are elements, maximum front is pointing to the maximum index, and if it is true, then set the front equal to 0 and then return the element. Means what? If front is pointing to size minus 1, then you have to make the front as 0, because it has to start to add the element from the 0, because that is nothing but the end of your queue. So this is how we are going to write the code for the NQ operation. You can see here, whatever the conditions I have explained you over here, that we are going to add. When front is minus 1, you have to make it as 0. Initially, when queue is, you're going to insert the element. IsFull is the function that has this condition, full, for a full queue. If it is not full, then you'll go for the else part. Okay, if complete queue is empty, means this condition will be there, then make the front as 0. Then you have to add the element at the rear end. And every time rear, you have to go for the next one, means forward. One after the other, the location you have to change for the rear, and you have to put the element in the queue. So these two are the things that you have to make. Rear equal to rear plus 1 mod size. So it will get incremented every time. And it should be in a circular manner. That's why we have to do this computation. Mod size. Okay. And then we have to insert the element in the circular queue. Then for a DQ, again, empty condition has to be checked. Else not, then you have to check where there is only one element is there or not. Else, what you have to do? You have to make the front for the next, and you're going to remove that particular element from your queue. So this is how the DQ operation use. And the last is a display function. In display function, we have to print the elements in the queue starting from front to rear, because front will show you the element start, because that is the thing from where we are going to delete the element. So starting from front till the rear, you are going to print the element. So this is the for loop we have to use every time when we have to display the elements in the circular queue. Okay, so this will be the program that we have for writing the circular queue different operations. Okay, now we have next question. Given a program to print a Pascal triangle. Again, the same Pascal triangle is there. But this program has an error which prevent it from printing it. And what we have to do is, we have to find the problem in this, and we have to solve the problem. So what kind of errors this particular program is showing? What we have to give input integer, that number of rows we want to print, and output is going to be the Pascal triangle. See here, the formula for calculating the coefficient, I think that is the problem. This should be I minus j. We have seen the formula, right? We have seen the previous Pascal triangle. So this should be I minus j. And another thing. No, that is the only thing that we have to change. Yes, coefficient is assigned incorrect values. So that this should be minus over here. That is the one change we have to do. And one more is the inner loops conditions are wrong. Inner loop conditions means which? For I equal to 0, I less than rows. The second one is? Yes, anybody knows? I am also searching the same thing for right now only. So I don't know what is the answer for this also. So you also please try and tell me or help me for finding the errors also. What inner loop problem is there? Yes, here also you need I, j is less than or equal to I. So that is also the one problem we have over here. Because it is, it will not go till the end of the loop. There will be one element will be left, skipped from this for loop. You have to write j is less than equal to I for this problem. Okay, this is the another. Given a program to print the pattern shown below. Write a program to print the mirror image of the given pattern. Okay. So given pattern is, I think this pattern is the given pattern and this is the mirror image that we have to print. So which kind of changes you have to do in the program so you will print this mirror image. I'll show directly the code for you because this much part is going to be same for this. For printing the spaces and the there is a no need to print a space, I think. So this complete for loop we are going to change and this is going to be the for loop we are going to write for printing the mirror image. That is the simple one because we don't have to give the spaces like this as they have given. We have to just mirror this image. So we'll start with the starting index only. There is no need to give the spaces. So this for loop is not going to be there. Only one for loop is going to be there and these conditions are not required for that. We'll just directly go and write the code for this. Okay, this is a simple one. I think if you know the nested for loops, how you can use, then this is the simple logic to write the program for this kind of a output. Start with the first one, only one aesthetic you have to print, then two, then three, then four. That way you're going to print it. Okay, now we have the next question. This is also a tricky one related to ternary operator. Again, you have what you have to do is you have to evaluate the expressions every time. This is the first one, the second one, third one. And this one is. You have to put one thing over in this so you will get the answer. So this expression will give you the answer as 2 is greater than 5, not equal to 1. Means this will give you 0. And 0 is not equal to 1. So this entirely give you a answer as a 1. Then 5 is less than 8 and 8 is greater than 2. This will also give you 1. Then this 5 is there. So what you have to add in this, so you will get the answer this, the second one. No? So I think you have to write negation over here. So 0 will be there. So if it is 0, then it won't execute, it won't go for the third option, fourth option of this output. Yes, you have to put the negation symbol near 5. this 5. So you will get the answer as 200. Okay, the same problem they have given again. Okay, then we have finished with the C programming part. After this, we'll have the next, that is related to the data structure. And we'll take a break for a 15 minutes now, and then we'll join. Okay, so it's already 6:36. So 6:45 we'll meet. Not exactly the... Okay, 6:50 we'll meet again for the remaining part. Is it okay with you? Yes? Or should I start to with the next one? Yes? Nobody is giving the response. I think all are tired. Yes?
Yes, ma'am, start next one.
Okay, I'll start with the next one. Or I think we'll take a break for 15 minutes and then we'll start. So I also need a break. Okay. After a 15-minute break, we'll come and join. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Yes.